Welcome you all in the lecture of Geotechnical Engineering Part 1. In some areas this subject is called as a Geotechnical Engineering and in some areas this subject is called as a Soil Mechanics. So when we are going to construct any structure like building structure or bridge or dam, we construct it on the ground. So before construction we must know what are the properties of soil. And by knowing those properties, we have to design the foundation of structure. And we know the foundation is most important component in the structure because it transfers the structure's load to the ground. So therefore, for the foundation design, the study of soil is very important. So what is soil? We all know soil. But soil is defined as a material formed with solid particles, which particles are produced by disintegration of rocks. And these solid particles are loosely arranged, that is, these are unconsolidated. So basically, the soil is a unconsolidated material. Then the soil mechanics. The term soil mechanics was introduced first by Dr. Karl Terzaghi in 1925. The soil mechanics is a branch of mechanics in which the action of forces on soil is studied with flow of water in soil. So, in the soil mechanics, we have to study the different forces acting on the soil with flow of water in soil. Then the term geotechnical engineering is a broader term. It includes soil mechanics and geology. But geotechnical engineering, it is also used as a synonym for a soil mechanics. Now, what are the objectives of soil mechanics? The first objective is to develop the soil testing methods. Then by those methods we have to find the different soil properties, and depending upon those properties we have to classify the soil. And then after classification we have to decide which soil is suitable for construction or not. Here the soil is considered as a construction material. If someone asks what are the construction material, then we answer that the bricks or cement, concrete, these are construction material. But remember, the soil is also a construction material. Then what is the formation of soil? What is the process of formation of soil? In this we have to see what is the geological cycle. We all know how the rocks are formed. When hot molten magma cools down, then the rocks are formed, and due to the disintegration of these rocks the soil particles are produced, and by some natural processes this soil is converted to the rocks. So this cycle is called as a geological cycle. So basically it is a rocks are converted to the soil, and again soil is converted to the rocks. This is called as a geological cycle. There are three phases in geological cycle. First one is weathering of rocks, second one is transportation of soil, and then third one is earth movement. Okay, now the first one is weathering of rocks. There are two types. One is physical weathering, then second one is chemical weathering. In the physical weathering, the erosion of rocks is due to the high flowing wind or due to the high flowing water, and the soil produced by physical weathering is sand or gravel. Then the next one is chemical weathering. Due to humid environment and rainwater, rock is decomposed chemically and it results in the formation of crystalline particles, that is clay minerals. In this case, the soil is formed at the same place of rock. So therefore, these soils are called as a residual soils. And the example is laterite. In case of laterite, due to the rainwater, the soluble minerals in the rock are removed with the rainwater, and some insoluble minerals like hydroxides of iron and aluminium are remained. Okay, and this forms the soil. So therefore, the color of the laterite is red brown color. The next phase is the transportation of soil. The transportation of soil is due to the two agents, that is by flowing water or and by the flowing wind. So here consider the first case, transportation of soil by flowing water. Now consider this figure. Here the flow of water, direction of flow of water is denoted. Then this is a original ground level. So this is a original ground level, and here and from this point the slope of the ground is reduced. Okay, so here the ground level is flat. So due to the high flow of water, the ground eroded, and the new eroded ground level is here. So this is the eroded ground level. Due to the high flow of water, the large soil particles, that is sand and gravel, are carried with the flow of water and are deposited at this place where the velocity of water is reduced. So here, so in this region, the sand and gravel are deposited. So we must know the particle size. Okay, soil particle size. So for the gravel, the particle size is 4.75 mm and larger than that. For the sand, the soil particle size 4.75 mm to 75 micron. Then for the silt, it is a 75 micron to 0.02 micron. For the clay, it is a less than 0.02 micron. Then the soil particles like silt and clay are deposited beyond this sand and gravel. So these are silt particles are somewhat greater than clay. So therefore, these are deposited here in this region, and the clay particles are deposited in this region. Okay. Now, the next transporting agent of the soil is wind. The wind is also transports the soil particles. So in arid conditions or in the semi-arid conditions, the velocity of flow of wind is very high, and due to this high flowing wind, the rocks get eroded and the soil particles are produced. These soil particles are transported with the flow of wind, and this soil which is transported by the wind is called as a loess. This soil is called as a loess, and basically it is a silt deposit, and the loess particles are uniformly graded. That is, the each and every particle have the same size, have the same range of size, and have the same properties. Okay, and this size of particles is in the range of 0.01 mm to 0.05 mm. Then loess has low density and high compressibility. Okay, now the last phase in the geological cycle is earth movement. Now when the flow of water reduces, okay, then the soil particles settles at the bottom. So these soil particles settles at the bottom, this process is continuous for the long period, and the horizontal layers of the soil particles over one another are formed, and these are called as a strata, and these are called as a strata. Okay, when these strata compacted, they form a rock, and these rocks are called as a sedimentary rocks. The examples of the sedimentary rocks are shell, sandstone, and chalk. Okay, now this is the geological cycle, the three phases of geological cycle. The first one is the weathering of rock, then the second one is the transportation of soil, the third one is the earth movement. In the last phase, the soil is again converted to the rock. Okay, now we will see what are the types of soil. There are many types of soil, but here some few are listed. The first one is bentonite. Bentonite forms due to the decomposition of volcanic ash. Then next one is black cotton soil. It is residual soil, and it contains the clay mineral montmorillonite, and it have low bearing capacity. We have seen what is residual soil. So residual soil is the soil formed at the same place of rocks. So that type of soil is called as a residual soil. And the next one is boulders. These are rock fragments larger than 300 mm size. Then the next one is clay. It is a fine grained cohesive soil, and the size of particles is less than 0.002 mm. The next is hardpans. These are very dense, well graded cohesive aggregates of mineral particles, and they offer great resistance for disintegration. So these are very dense mineral particles, so that they cannot disintegrated by the flow of water. The next one is the loam. It is a mixture of sand, silt, and clay, and the final one is loess. We have already seen what is loess. It is a silt type soil deposited by a flow of wind, and the size of particles is between 0.01 to 0.05 mm, and the particles are uniformly graded. Okay, so these are some types of soil.